learned from the lessons that Floyd has had. What has it meant to you, and what does it mean for you going forward in terms of the way you handle your business, more specifically outside the boxing ring?
Like you said, you know, our relationship, you know, when we talk, it's very personal, and you try to keep me level-headed, because sometimes I can get high-headed.
Sometimes, you know, sometimes he can, you know, he call me, and he have his days. Every day is not the same. Sometimes he have his days, and I say, Adrien, come on, you gotta rock with me, because, in our own language, that's our language, of course. You know, my background, of course, I come from the inner city. I'm a chameleon, I'm not adjust and adapt to any situation, but I tell you, you gotta stay with me. I need you. You're one of the biggest names in boxing. And even though I'm not out there competing or fighting anymore, I still live for these fighters. You know, when these fighters go out there and win, I feel like I'm fighting. So I know how it feels to be on this side, and I know how it feels to be a fighter. But every day, I say to myself, I got in the sport of boxing as a promoter. When I got older, I got in the sport of boxing as a promoter to help fighters, to help them. Because for so many years, fighters have been taken advantage of. And in the beginning, I didn't understand the business, even though when I was 19, you know, I was 19 years old, a teenager, I touched down in Las Vegas. And it was a six-figure check right there on the desk. I went into Top Rank office. I didn't see nothing. I didn't care what it said. You know, I said, okay, where to sign it? Because, you know, I gotta realize I'm a kid from the inner city, and I did have, you know, I had an up and down life, whereas when I stayed in Jersey with my mother, I lived 7 deep in a 1-bedroom in a project building. And then when I stayed with my, in Michigan, with my grandma, because she raised me, I never really had a stable home. You know, sometimes I stay at my dad's, sometimes I stay with my mother. But through all that, through everything that I've been through, it made me who I am today. And that's the same thing. All my trials and tribulations and things that I've been through, I try to help Adrien and give him the same advice. I want him to be better than me. I want him to surpass me. I want my records to be broken, because I would like to be here to see my records be broken. I'm like, damn, it finally happened. You know, I don't care if it's 4 years from now, 10 years from now, I want to see it happen. I mean, that's because I feel like I knew I was going to get to a certain level. I just didn't know how high, but I kept believing, you know, every time. And this is the truth. When I used to see fighters fighting, it's no different from when I seen Adrien Broner fight Maidana. And I said this to myself. I said, this motherfucker got hurt. This motherfucker's tough. And it made me respect Adrien Broner a lot more once I faced Maidana. For him to come from a small weight, because you gotta realize, even though I jumped from a small weight, I gradually moved up. Because that's the way you're supposed to do. He made a big jump. And I'm gonna be honest, Maidana's one of the hardest hitting motherfuckers I ever fought. And Adrien Broner can vouch for that. He hit hard. But you know, for Adrien Broner to get knocked down by Maidana and hop up and continue to fight and say, motherfucker, I'm still here, I ain't going nowhere. I mean, if you're not a fighter, you would never understand that. But if you're a fighter and you've been in the crunch, it's a motherfucker in there. And I just want to tell Adrien, I'm proud of him. You know, I'm proud of him through all the stuff that he's been through. He's still able to go out there and perform. But the main thing is, he's a good father. He's always with his children. And just like myself, you know, I'm always going to be a great father. Before I'm be known as a great boxing champion, I'm going to be known as a great father. Because that's the thing that's important to me, because our children are the future. So we want to make sure that our children surpass us and be better than us. And I just tell Adrien on the regular, it's all about business. It's not what you can do inside the ring. What can you do once you get on that? We have to turn that into something. And so, and those are the conversations we have. And yeah, a lot of times they see us joking and laughing and smiling, but to get, you know, a G4 jet, to get a G3 jet, to get Rolls Royces, and to get diamond watches. That's after. That's later on. All I ever wanted, and the same thing like Adrien. And I think it's really my fault. I say for all these young fighters that's coming up, that's really my fault, because when they young, they see Floyd Mayweather, they watch. At one particular time, it was 24/7. They watch All Access, and they see me flashy, flamboyant. They were like, so if I was a kid, I'd be like, I gotta get that same thing. But I don't wanna. I really wanna tell these young fighters, my whole focus, all I really wanted to be, was the best. I didn't care. When I went to Top Rank sometimes, and they said, well, we can't afford to pay you for this fight, this next fight on this date. I said, how much can you pay me? If they gave me a number, just throw a hypothetical throw number out there. They said, I only can pay you $7,500, $10,000. I'm like, give it to me. Because I seen the bigger picture. I wasn't thinking about just right now. I knew I was going to have a long career because my dad told me this. This is the first thing my dad installed in me when I was younger. He said, the less you get hit, the longer you last. So, and now I look back at my career, still sharp. As of right now, I'm still sharp. I'm still on point. I didn't let the sport retire me. I retired from the sport. I mean, shit, if I was Steven, would I want Floyd Mayweather to come back? Absolutely. I'd give him the whole Brinks truck.
I'm off.
But, you know, this is about Adrien. I stand behind Adrien. I want to continue to support him. Sometimes he'd be upset. Big bro, no. Just relax. You know, I'm here with you. Just relax. You know, he's only human. I mean, and it's just like this. You know, they're going to take shots at him, but I tell them all the time. Certain people in the media or certain people on social media or people that don't even know you. Everybody's an internet thug. Everybody's an internet gangster. Everybody can type up something negative about you, something bad about you. Everybody can make up fake stories. At the end of the day, I tell him that this. Like, everybody here right now can judge me and say, oh, yeah, we know what I'm saying. I mean, at the end of the day, that little lady right there, that's what I care about. And that's the same thing that he should care about. Your children, because that's who's going to love you through thick and thin, through it all. If you make a lot of money, if you lose it all, your children are going to love you unconditional. The media is going to move on to the next. The fans is going to move on to the next. They're going to keep inventing more and more fighters. At one time it was Junior Hernandez. This kid is crazy for fighting him. Then they come and say, Angel Man Freddy, the next best guy that quit. They wipe him out the box. Then they say, oh, this guy. Then they say, oh, that guy. Then they keep building it. Then they say, Diego Corrales on the field. Then they say, Ricky Hatton. Then they say, De La Hoya. Then they say, Canelo. Then they say, Pacquiao. And all I say is this. I tell AB this. Always have patience. You want to get to where you're trying to get to. A true champion can take a loss and bounce back. And I don't have to take a loss in the ring because I took losses on the outside of the ring. When I lose a loved one, that hurts deep. No different from my best friend killed himself on FaceTime when he committed suicide and murdered his wife. You don't think that hurt? But still, mentally, I have to be in the right place because I know that I have a whole company. I have a whole company that's backing me and believing in me. I didn't want to let Steven down. When I went to Steven and I said, this is the deal I want. First, I went to HBO and said, this is the deal I want right here. And once they couldn't get the deal done, it's not like I wasn't loyal because nobody knew this. I fought under HBO for years. Just fight to fight. And it was telling the world, making the world think that I was under a contract, and I wasn't. Fight to fight. Then I finally said, when I came home from doing my little small bid, I said, listen, this is the deal that I need. They said, nobody's gonna get him that deal. I went to Steve, he said, no problem. So I will always be loyal to, you know, I'm always be loyal to people that treated me good. And they didn't treat me good, they treated me great. Within my deal, everything that I wanted within my deal, I got. And everything that I asked for within my career, I got, but I had to go out there and produce first. You have to go out there and produce first. And I say, okay, I say, yo, listen, I need this big boy mansion built. It costs $15 million. I need it. I need this built. I said, no problem. I was retired when I got that built. Okay, that's one thing. When I wanted Bugatti, I got it. When I wanted three jets, I got it. But I had to go out there and produce. This is not nothing that happened overnight. Same thing with Adrien Broner. He gonna get to where he got, where he wanted to get to. I'd have been in the gym. I don't have to see a fighter fight. I can see him in a boxing gym, and I can just see certain movements. I say, oh yeah, I can see why he's world champion. Because when I say this, I really mean this. Maidana can punch. And I'd have been in there with some of the best. And every guy that's at the top can punch. They all can punch. No different from when you look at, we look at Canelo, and then we look at Amir Khan. And they say, oh, Mayweather did this to Canelo, so Amir Khan's gonna be able to do the same thing. It's two totally different fighters. It's two totally different worlds. There's a difference between, I tell y'all this all the time, there's a difference between being talented and God-gifted. It's two different. You got a lot of talented fighters. But when you mix them all together, I'm talented and God-gifted. So I got two things on my side. Most fighters only got one thing. And we will see Adrien Broner. We will see the best of Adrien Broner. And this guy that he's fighting is not a pushover. And I'm gonna continue to help him grow and push his company. You know, it's a great feeling to wake up and say, damn, I took this guy who was just, this fighter who was walking to the boxing gym and taking a bus to the boxing gym to making seven-figure paydays, but I had to work. It wasn't easy. Badou Jack never complained, though. He never complained. He never complained. He never cried. All he said is, every time we got him a fight, he never complained about the money. Most of these fighters nowadays, all they do is bitch and complain about the money. We want the money. We want what Mayweather got. Well, you have to take the same road Mayweather took. I fought 17 times in a year and a half before I fought for, that's the reason why I fought for the world title, and I fought the best guy at the weight. And then once you get to a certain point, a certain pinnacle where you accomplish everything that you want to accomplish, then you got to say, what next? Then you want to see people, everybody around you, win and accomplish certain things. Because there's nothing else I can really do in the sport no more. You late, Leonard?
No, God, I already been here.
Okay, well, come back. Okay, well, I'm going to pass the mic back over to A. Go ahead.
So just so you guys know, we're about the middle of the Thomas DeLorme fight, about round five. So if we want to do one or two more questions.
Yeah, wait, can you take some more questions? Go ahead. Go ahead. I'm sorry.
No, Adrien, you know, I know you had a challenging year last year. How did that change your perspective and change you?
Last year, you know, was one of the roughest years of my profession. And, you know, I've been through some humbling moments. And, you know, it's good I got mentors like Floyd Mayweather, you know. It's good I got positive people like Broner and Adrian inside of me. And, you know, they helped me get through these situations. And now we're on better and positive things.
What changes have you made in particular? Have you maybe changed any of the people around you? Or? I said, what changes have you made? Have you changed any of the people around you? Because Floyd before was talking about having positive people around him.
Most definitely. You know, you definitely got to, you know, he tell me this all the time. You know, once you decide to do right, you're going to lose a lot of your friends or, well, a lot of people that you thought was your friend. You know, because a lot of people are around for the wrong reasons. And now that I'm doing right and now that I'm not clubbing so much or doing the crazy wild stuff that I used to do. You know, it's a lot of people that really don't want to come around or don't get around anymore. So, you know, we're just doing all positive things, and that's the new thing for me.
And also, I you know, you were saying before that you can't fight Maidana right now because he's retired, but would you like to avenge the loss of Porter at some point?
Of course. But like I said before, you know, my main objective is February 18th and putting on a great show for you guys and all my fans.
Floyd, what are some similarities you see between yourself and Adrien, both inside and outside the ring?
Well, what I want Adrien to do is go back to that combination punch of Adrien Broner. Because if you go back to, you know, when you go back and look at me in the beginning, before I became Money Mayweather, when I was Pretty Boy Floyd, man, I was a motherfucker then. you know, once I reached my last hurrah really was with Arturo Gatti. After I reached that point, my body was all broken down, you know, just from so, not just from taking punishment, but for just so many different hard training camps, pushing myself day in and day out, It was wear and tear on the body, hands broke down, body broke down. Still able to work, that's why I had to start working even harder, just so I can compete, I mean, at the highest level, but because my body had broke down. My last hurrah was with Arturo Gatti, and I still, since I had a sharp mind and I didn't take any punishment, I still was able to beat all the top fighters, you know, with chess moves, just being smart, and just with my experience. Far as on the outside, what I see from Adrien, you know, just he has what it takes, because if you look at his social media following, he has a hell of a following, and a lot of fighters don't have as many followers as Adrien Broner has. You got guys that's been to the Olympics and won medals and still don't have that charisma and what it takes to be the next thing. Adrien, he can box, he can punch, he got fast hands, but I never go back to that combination puncher that when I first went to Cincinnati, I was like, little kid can fight. I said, he talking some shit like he means, he can fight. And then he would, you know, the first time I seen him fight, another time I seen him fight, I like was he swept this kid with a left hook. Jason, I don't know his last
name. Litzau.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, he swept him with a hook in Mexico in the first round, if I'm not mistaken. Then I seen him fight in Cincinnati. So I was like, this kid gonna make some noise.